Hello everyone, welcome back to Rayman Origins. In this part, we finish up our retread into the old levels, and I don't remember if we start the final world, but we at the very least finish this one, so good for us.
Beware of Minnie Murray. For some reason, like, my brain dropped to Bill Murray instead of referring to, and I'm just like,
it's Minnie Murray, and then you just see a Bill Murray that's half the size of the original Bill.
No, he's not even half. No, the joke with Bill Murray would be he's not like half the size, or maybe he's like 2 inches shorter.
You know what? A mini Bill Murray that's like 3 or 4 inches shorter than a regular Bill Murray is a very like Bill Murray kind of joke. So I could see that for sure. Minnie Murray, I think, is just one of the enemies in this game, but like many other platformers, you don't know any of the names of the enemies in this game. There isn't even like an end of game like enemy reel where you can learn what the names to all the enemies are after the fact, which was always something weird about like Donkey Kong Country or whatever, in that like if you played Donkey Kong Country growing up and you never had the manual, like you didn't know what all those guys are. It was just like red crocodile, green crocodile, beaver.
Well, until you beat the game.
Yeah,
anyway.
But like by then the time you beat the game, like how likely are you to remember their names the next time you try to play the game, you know?
Well, that depends on the enemy, because I remember Naughty and very Naughty.
I mean, the boss stages were always just the name of the boss, so.
So, yeah, so, like, remembering the bosses, sure, but, like, I don't know how likely I would be to remember Kremling if I had not known that was their name before I had played the game, you know?
Who the fuck is Donkey?
The Donkey is the key you get in Kingdom Hearts to open the Dong door.
Okay.
Or, you know what, like, I can just imagine that, like, in the Donkey Kong world in Kingdom Hearts, you unlock the Dawn key, like Dawn as in the sun. It's just like it's the Dong key, which opens up the heart door in the Donkey Kong world.
I was more thinking of like a mob boss key. It's like the Dawn key. This is my key, Sora. How dare you bring these heartless to the day of my daughter's wedding?
To the day of Candy Kong's wedding. This is not bananas. This is crystal coconut. This is not bananas.
Is the centipede thing can actually break the things you need to break?
Yeah, that happens a lot of the time in this game, where like enemies will kill each other, or like they'll break something that kills the other enemies. I think that's supposed to be like a weird cross reference to Pac-Man and Centipede at the same time. But yeah, there were like instances like where we would like hit something and it would knock a barrel down and it could kill all of the enemies you need to open the chest. There's a lot of creative things they do with that throughout this game. This game's just...
I'm still stuck on Don Corleone speaking like monkey speak or something. I don't know, like, why that lingered in my head.
Donkey Kong. You have not even found most of the secret exits in this game. You're a disgrace of a Donkey Kong.
Can you imagine like Don Corleone like speaking like Zoomer speak, like Twitch speak, like in today's world?
Follow my TikTok.
Like, you come to me on my daughter's wedding. That's not very poggers of you.
Look how they bass massacred my boy. They default dancing all over my boy.
Sheesh.
I'm gonna eat that boy right out of my office.
What are you saying, boss? And that's why he actually died.
I have no idea what he's fucking saying.
Yeah, that's when he just dies.
Oh, man. You know what? I still to this day have not watched Godfather Part 2. I watched Part 1, but not Part 2.
I listened to part one.
What? Listened?
Godfather part one. I finally watched it myself a couple of years ago. And I could not understand a goddamn word that guy was saying.
Oh, I put on the subtitles.
I put on the subtitles.
I do that for Lord of the Rings as well. Because Lord of the Rings has really weird sound balancing that's very clearly intended for the theater. In which a lot of the conversations are too quiet to hear, but if you turn up the volume to hear them, as soon as you get to an action scene, your ears are gonna blow off. So wait, I just leave.
They pushed because that was done. That was an era where like they pushed surround sound, like home surround sound, big yeah. on the movie.
So I just turn on the subtitles and not mess with changing the volume every 10 to 20 minutes.
I'm like trying to figure out why I'm not having that problem with when I watch Lord of the Rings, and it's probably because I wear headphones whenever I do anything.
Oh, that
yeah, no. Whenever I've watched Lord of the Rings, it was in the family room with my dad. Oh,
yeah.
So couldn't really do that. But yeah, no. When I was watching the Godfather, my dad was like, "This movie's great. I'm gonna turn on the subtitles for the first half of the movie until he dies." But you see, when you said that, I thought you were referring to like listening to the audiobook. And I've never read it, but apparently, The Godfather is one of the examples of a movie that's much better than the book, so that's why I was surprised.
That happens more often than you think it does.
I can only think of two examples off the top of my head. One is I've heard of The Godfather. The other is Starship Troopers, because Starship Usually, Troopers sucks as a book. The book.
I didn't realize Starship Troopers was a
yeah,
book.
Yeah, it's not a good book.
It's played very straight in the book. Meanwhile, the movie is so over the top, you can't help but view it as a parody.
So it's because it's a RoboCop director. Point,
so, yeah.
Well, the movie's definitely aiming to be a parody because, like, you know, you've got all of the like 1950s-esque, "I'm doing my part," and then you see like the little kid who's like, "I'm doing my part," and he's in the full battle gear, and like everybody's like, ah, ha, ha, ha. But like that kid's actually going to go out and die. I've not read the whole book. I've read like a bit of it, and it's awful.
No, but did you watch RoboCop?
I have not watched RoboCop. Was that a book?
Same dude who directed Starship Troopers, and like the movies are very alike, and they're awesome for it.
Well, I mean, RoboCop definitely, like RoboCop does not think that the concept of a RoboCop is a good thing. It's more that like this one guy just happens to be a decent guy. And he's able to fight through the RoboCop programming. Although I've never seen the sequels, so I don't know like if they pivot onto actually RoboCops would be awesome because they are cops with missiles for arms.
I think that's entirely the reason why the sequels don't hold up as well. Like if you just need to watch one, you watch the
original. Also the South Korea fried chicken commercial.
A lot of the times when a movie ends up being better or on par with the book, it's because the people making the movie had their own point to say, so it's like they were adding to the conversation.
Let's see, Fight Club's better as a movie than it is a book.
Also, like, sometimes it's just because the story is action-focused, and it's a lot easier to pull off a good action scene visually. Not everyone is R.A. Salvatore.
Yeah, I found that a lot of fantasy and sci-fi authors have a hard time writing action scenes that don't feel really cluttered and all over the place.
Yeah, that's why I say not everyone is R.A. Salvatore, because he's like the only author that I know who routinely writes good action scenes, as in action scenes that are easy to follow and feel as dynamic as like visual action scenes.
But I know that like movies generally have to have somewhat of a different, like not point, but like they have to approach things in a different way because books by their nature are longer and thus have more time to like develop their points. So movies have to kind of go for something. You have to approach the problem from a different way.
Well, there's also the point that because of the format that a book is written in, they can focus more on the thoughts and feelings of the characters and don't necessarily have to rely quite so much on plot. Whereas a movie has to like be pretty tightly structured in that sense.
It has the benefit of visual storytelling, though, at least. But you know, at that point, it falls to the creators to use that environment well to convey what they're trying to express.
Which is why, like, The Lost World, Jurassic Park, the movie was pretty awful because they basically had to make up an entire plot of their own, and it didn't work out so well for them.
But like, take for example, like what would be in a movie, like a 10-second scene of seeing a character's emotional reaction to something would be like could be up to 2 pages or more in a book, and those just have completely different feelings, you know. Like when you're reading someone's emotional reaction to something, that's a very different feeling than watching someone's emotional reaction to something that only takes a couple of seconds. Yeah.
Another good point of comparison with The Lost World, actually, is like, okay, the kids in that particular story, they have no resemblance to the one in the movie, by the way. It's kind of like, okay, there's this black boy named Arby and there's this white girl named Kelly. You might notice that the movie fused them into a black girl named Kelly who had none of either character's personality traits, but never mind. The point is, their entire story arc was Kelly's this girl who's pretty smart and interested in stuff like science, and every adult or fellow kid in her life tells her that a girl being smart and academic is a bad thing because boys won't like that. Her only friend is Arby, who is this genius level grade schooler who keeps getting knocked up grades because he's just too good for whatever grade he happens to be in. So he's advancing classes and she's terrified he's going to advance classes again and then she's going to have no friends. Okay, so these two kids get wrapped up in Ian Malcolm and Professor Levine's crazy expedition to Site B, which is not to save the dinosaurs in the book. It's actually just to study extinction patterns, but never mind. Like I said, the book has no plot, but their entire story arc is about the way adults discourage kids from being academically inclined. And all of that is very interesting to read about, but nothing, like, not a whole lot actually happens with it that could be translated into a movie, because it's all going on inside the characters' heads the entire time. And it's like, okay, how do you make that work in a movie adaptation? The answer that Spielberg apparently came up with is you don't. You just make you just have the kids fusion dance incorrectly into a non-academically inclined kid who does gymnastics and has daddy issues.
She also wants to play Sega a lot.
That too, yeah. So basically, it's the opposite of what those two kids were.
Yeah, I think you also run the issue of that a lot of, like, books can be preachy just as much as movies can be preachy. Often they're more so.
Oh, yes.
But it's it's just more blatant when you do it in a movie because the characters will literally preach at you with their words.
I mean, it's funny that you say that because Ian Malcolm, his book counterpart is way preachier than his movie counterpart because that's
his movie counterpart is pretty preachy.
His entire role in both books is to get injured, get hopped up on morphine painkillers, and then spend the rest of the book giving like semi doped up lectures about various scientific philosophical things. So like, and, like, a lot of his dialogue lines in the original Jurassic Park movie are just little snippets of the pages-long lectures he gives other characters during the novel. He is the preachiest motherfucker. And, it's like, one of the funnier meta-jokes in Jurassic Park 3, for the people who actually read the book, is that when Grant asks the kid, "Did you read Malcolm's book?" And the kid talks about how, yeah, I read Malcolm's book, but it was so preachy. Everything's chaos. And it's like, yeah, that's pretty much how Malcolm talks in the books. Everything is chaos.
Oh, look at that. The tutorial guy is telling us to don't go this way. Interesting that he's telling us not to go this way.
Prepare to be bubbleized.
Yeah, that's what they say. And then he goes back to his default. I wonder why he would tell us not to go final boss.
You did get bubbleized.
Oh, yeah, you're right. It's like, see, told you. Dumbass.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, so this is the final world of the game. Also, I don't know. This is just cool, like the storm clouds thing. I don't know. I feel like it's underutilized, like being in an actual storm cloud. Have any of you guys flown through a storm on a plane?
Yes.
And did you ever look out the window while you were there?
No, because I was in a fetal position, okay, processing two drinks and hoping I don't fucking die. Because it was actually after the Sonic 2 premiere. One of our layover flights was in New York, Jersey, and it was one of those smaller planes.
Oh, okay.
In the middle of the night, bunch of turbulence. And the thing about smaller planes, they shake a lot more.
Yeah. Okay. So then, because I was going to say, if you ever look out the window, it's really cool. But, like, if you're in a small plane, then you're probably freaking out. So it's probably not so much cool as terrifying at that point.
Okay, so here's the thing about me and planes is that nothing will ever faze me on planes again. Because, all right, one of the few semi-valuable things I learned while I was at that fucking scam school was some stuff about engineering. Specifically engineering where it relates to stuff like airplanes. And I learned actually quite a bit about the absurd lengths that they go to make sure that airplanes are safe, and how hideously freak unusual it is for anything to go wrong. on the surface, the idea of flying through or over or around a storm in an airplane sounds pretty bad. But they've put so much redundant thought and planning into everything that could possibly happen on an airplane that the likelihood of it actually being a thing is... The likelihood of it actually being a thing that you need to worry about is astronomically low. Like...
Just hope the pilots don't share the same meal so they don't both get sick on chicken.
Yeah, but I mean, it's more dangerous to drive in a storm than it is to fly in a storm.
Yeah.
Like, in the old Superman movies where he'd be like, flying is still the safest way to travel. He's right. It is the safest way to travel.
It's just that it's so easy for your mentality to snowball.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not a lot. Fear isn't logical. So,
and that's why I say I have an advantage because I have all this information in my head about what they do, how they do it, and like what it means for me as a passenger on a plane. That the notion that something could go wrong strikes my brain.
What if this is the flight where the EMP goes off?
Well, they have plans for that too.
It's still probably terrifying to be the pilot. Like, one of the things I remember is the year I drove to TMG. On the way back, it started raining really hard, and I just pulled over, and I had to drive for like 5-10 minutes before I could pull over, and I was just like terrified because I could barely see what was going on outside of the windshield, and it was just awful.
Oh yes. So like, with me, when I'm doing my delivery and rideshare trips, like. None of your absurd bonuses or pay offers will ever get me to drive when it's storming or snowing out.
I've only had to drive in a blizzard once, and that was also awful. A ride that normally takes me 45 minutes took me 2 hours and 45 minutes because I was going like 15 miles an hour tops. It's terrifying, dude.
Are you paid extra in rideshares for driving in inclement weather? Like,
they generally will end up offering bonuses for inclement weather purely because there are less drivers out driving, and they need to encourage people to come out. So they'll offer bonuses to like coax people out onto the road so that they'll have drivers available.